So, the next item of business, I think we're now facing forward to the chair. Thank you very much. The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 13909 in the name of Bill Kidd on the late Reverend John Ainslie. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press your request to speak button, and I call on Bill Kidd to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Now, today we're here to recognise the remarkable contributions of the late Reverend John Ainslie to the debate on nuclear weapons. Now, John was not just a leading man and a leading figure in Scotland's anti-nuclear movement. He was someone whose life's work and deep commitment to peace profoundly shaped the discourse on disarmament here and abroad. And I hope his legacy will be honoured not only in words, but also in actions as we go forward. While today's debate pays tribute to John's invaluable work, it also provides an opportunity to renew our commitment to nuclear disarmament and to a nuclear-free Scotland. I would like to take a moment to welcome those from the Nuclear Information Centre and the Scottish Campaign for Nuclear Disarmament to the public gallery, and just say your efforts are vital as we continue the existence and proliferation of nuclear weapons here in Scotland and around the world. The Nuclear Information Service plays an essential role in this ongoing effort, providing rigorous, reliable information on the UK's nuclear weapons programme. It is through such efforts that we can engage in informed debates and challenge the dangerous and costly status quo of nuclear armament. After this debate, there will be a meeting of the Cross-Party Group on Nuclear Disarmament and later an event at the National Library of Scotland to celebrate the return of the John Ainslie Archives. This event will feature a panel discussion with Scottish CND, the Nuclear Information Service and journalist Rob Edwards, further highlighting the importance of Reverend Ainslie's work. John's life was a journey defined by courage and conviction. Born in Aberdeenshire, he joined the Army in 1971 and studied international relations, becoming a junior officer. However, by 1980, his conscience led him to resign his commission as a conscientious objector, and he became a passionate advocate for nuclear disarmament. Returning to Scotland, he pursued a degree in divinity and joined the Church of Scotland as a youth worker, while also emerging as a prominent figure in the disarmament movement. In 1992, as the coordinator of Scottish CND, John made headlines by protesting against the arrival of the first submarine armed with Trident nuclear missiles on the Clyde. He did so with action, not just words. He paddled a canoe to confront the submarine, an act of bravery that led to his arrest by MOD police. This is a moment that symbolised his unwavering commitment to a world free from nuclear weapons. John combined rigorous academic inquiry with grassroots activism, ensuring that his contributions had both intellectual and practical impacts. He famously coined the phrase, "Bairns, not bombs," a powerful slogan that captures his vision of investing in our children and communities rather than weapons of mass destruction. This simple yet profound message continues to resonate today as we advocate for a nuclear-free future. The reports and research that Reverend Ainslie produced, now digitised by the Nuclear Information Service, remain vital in shaping international discourse on nuclear weapons. These documents are living tools that continue to inform global efforts towards disarmament, including the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. The return of these original documents to Scotland's National Library is more than symbolic. It's a reaffirmation of Scotland's role in the global peace movement. Nuclear disarmament is not just an idealistic goal, it's a practical necessity. The existence of nuclear weapons poses an existential threat to humanity. Their use, whether by design, accident or miscalculation, would have catastrophic consequences, and it's our moral duty to work relentlessly to eliminate these weapons from our world. The Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, which came into force in 2021, represents a historic step forward. Supported by a growing number of nations, this treaty explicitly bans the development, testing, production and possession of nuclear weapons. Scotland, through its people and its leaders, have consistently supported this treaty and the broader movement for disarmament. And John's work laid much of this groundwork for this support. However, significant challenges remain. Nuclear-armed states, including the UK, continue to resist these efforts, often citing deterrence as a justification. But the doctrine of deterrence is fundamentally flawed. It perpetuates a cycle of fear and insecurity and increases the risk of nuclear conflict. As long as the UK maintains its nuclear arsenal on Scottish soil, we find ourselves complicit in this dangerous status quo. Yet Scotland has the potential to be a beacon of hope, a nation that leads by example, advocating for disarmament and striving for a future where bairns not bombs is a reality. Presiding Officer, as we honour the life and legacy of the late John Ainslie, let us also commit ourselves to continuing his work. Let us strive for a Scotland and a world where peace, justice and human dignity are not overshadowed by the threat of nuclear weapons. John's example inspires us to challenge the status quo and work tirelessly for a safer and fairer future. Presiding Officer, let's use this moment to act, to renew our dedication to nuclear disarmament and to build a future where our children inherit a world free from the threat of nuclear annihilation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. I now call Rona Mackay to be followed by Jamie Green. Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to be speaking in this important debate, and I'd like to thank my colleague Bill Kidd for bringing it to the Chamber. I just want to say a few words about Bill at the moment. Bill Kidd's commitment to nuclear disarmament is well documented. He's the co-president of the global organisation Parliamentarians for Nuclear Non-Proliferation and Disarmament, and I applaud him for his unstinting work to get rid of the abomination of nuclear weapons from Scotland's shores and from the world. Of course, I also applaud the subject of today's debate, the Reverend John Ainslie. As we've heard, John Ainslie was the son of the manse in Aberdeenshire who joined the army in 1971, studied international relations at the University of Keele in Staffordshire and became a junior officer. By 1980, he'd fallen out with the army, resigned his commission as a conscientious objector and become an active campaigner. After paying back his university fees to the army, he undertook a divinity degree and entered the ministry of the Church of Scotland as a youth worker. He was one of Scotland's foremost disarmament campaigners, along, of course, with the late Canon Kenyon Wright. By 1992, when the first submarine armed with Trident nuclear missiles arrived in the Clyde, John, by then the coordinator of Scottish CND, was in a canoe buzzing the submarine when he was arrested by the MOD police. So as we've heard, John didn't pay lip service to disarmament. He did so with action and bravery, and his arrest was a watershed moment in highlighting the absurdity of these weapons of mass destruction. Presiding Officer, the SNP have a long-standing commitment to ridding our shores and the world of nuclear weapons. But until today's debate, I didn't realise that the often-used phrase, "bairns not bombs," was coined by John. For me, that slogan says it all. We want our children to grow up without the threat of nuclear weapons. Scotland doesn't want them. They have no place here. I personally have been a lifelong supporter of nuclear disarmament, having visited both Faslane and Green and Common back in the day. In fact, I think I still have the Protest and Survive badges and other memorabilia from then, and I'm keeping it to pass on to my grandchildren. The money that's spent on these useless weapons is staggering, and we could use that money in so many ways to build a fairer, greener Scotland. But for me, their presence here is symbolic of having no control of what happens to what the majority of Scots want and believe. Nuclear weapons are morally reprehensible. As Bill Kidd said, the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, which came into force in 2021, represents a historic step forward, along with the research produced by John Ainslie, now digitised by the Nuclear Information Service. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, can I thank Bill Kidd again for bringing forward this debate and for all peace-loving citizens and organisations for their work in ending the abomination of nuclear weapons. The most fitting tribute to John Ainslie would be to rid them from the beautiful shores of Scotland, something I'm confident will happen when we are an independent country. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Richard Leonard. Mr Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also congratulate Bill Kidd in bringing this debate to the Chamber. He and I have shared numerous debates on issues such as this over the years. And I'm perhaps maybe a strange choice to speak in this debate for a number of reasons. One, I am an MSP with a very keen interest in the work of our armed forces. I have the Faslane nuclear base in my parliamentary region, which I visited multiple times on site, and perhaps someone who would describe themselves as a supporter of our continuous at-sea deterrent, so that perhaps I am a strange choice for this debate. However, I would like to think that Reverend Ainslie, if he were here, would cherish this debate and all of our participation in it, because I actually have much positive to say about his work, even if perhaps he and I would have disagreed eye to eye in some of the substantive issues. But the underlying premise of his desire for peace across the world is one that I hope we all share, irrespective. He was, of course, coordinator of Scottish CND from 1991, when I was just 11, right through until his untimely death in 2016. I found it interesting in doing my research for this debate today. He trained to be an officer in the 1970s. He completed a degree in international relations. He specialised in NATO's nuclear strategy itself. Of course, he then went on to serve in our armed forces in Ireland. I'm reliably told, possibly even in military intelligence, I'm not sure, around the truth of that. But of course, he left, famously, as a conscientious objector, and he suffered a price for that. He faced tribunals, and he was forced to pay back some of his university fees. Looking back to that time when Vanguard, of course, the first of the Trident submarines, sailed up the Clyde right in front of my hometown of Greenock, he led a flotilla of around 50 small craft of swimmers and canoeists in the water. And I guess the sight of that huge submarine of mass destruction alongside the tiny canoes and the swimmers must have been an iconic vision of that epoch, because his many reports were very well received as being evidence-based, as being well argued, with the aim of persuading the public of his own convictions. And whether one agreed or not with his work, he provided a significant base of information about Britain's nuclear capabilities. Indeed, I would go as far as saying it enriched the debate around Britain's nuclear deterrent. Of course, they are weapons of mass death and destruction. He was right. Some would argue that is their very purpose. But his campaign was born in a very different world. Let's go back to 1992 when his first report was published. The Cold War was just over, the Berlin Wall had just come down, and the USSR had just collapsed. Of course, there was a feeling that a united Europe was giving way to perhaps to a more united world. There was actually optimism around at the time that perhaps that move towards an anti-nuclear world was gaining momentum and that disarmament would be universal. That optimism, perhaps, that sense of global unity has not lasted the test of time. I believe we are now in a far more dangerous and perhaps volatile world than we were in those days. The ongoing conflicts in Ukraine, the Middle East, tensions in the Taiwan Strait and elsewhere, I think, reinforce the role that Britain plays in our global affairs and the support we give to and receive from our global allies. The nuclear deterrent is undoubtedly part of that. But what Reverend Ainslie did is challenge the existence of it through substance. He scrutinised the standards of the deterrent. He challenged the risks associated with it. He maintained the many reports, which I don't have time to go into, were fascinating to read, and I look forward to seeing the National Records of Scotland when they come out. I would even argue that the UK's deterrent, as it is today, is all the more safer as a result of much of the work that those who even opposed its existence did. And that work is clearly ongoing, as is testament to those in the gallery today. What he did is, I think Bill Kidd summed it up very nicely, is he challenged the status quo. He asked difficult questions of people in power, perhaps questions that no one else was asking at the time. Questions about what is the price of security? What is the meaning of deterrence itself? What are the legalities around its potential use? And what are the realities of our global capabilities, both of us, our allies, and even our opponents? And I believe that we are, as a result, all the safer for some of that research and work. He made his arguments through the prism not of ideology, but through research, through thought-provoking analysis, and never, ever been afraid to question the safety or indeed the costs of our nuclear deterrent. There's one thing I am sad about is that he's not here to participate in this debate today. But nonetheless, I think his cause, his movement, his friends, family, and those who continue to fly the flag for him, including Bill Kidd, who I have much respect for, keep alive the memory of those bold figures of the early CND who were never, ever afraid to challenge the status quo. We never should be afraid to challenge the status quo. And that is something we should all cherish in a democracy such as ours. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Green. And I call Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also begin by thanking Bill Kidd for leading this afternoon's debate on a motion which celebrates the life and work of John Ainslie. Now, last month marked the 30th anniversary of a publication which I don't think is in the archive. It's a pamphlet which John and I co-authored, a co-production between the Scottish Campaign for Nuclear Disarmament and the Scottish Trades Union Congress. Trident, not safe, not economic, not wanted, is its title. In it, we exposed the huge hidden costs of Trident and exposed the huge safety risk it posed to the whole of central Scotland. It's a piece of work 3 decades on, which I am proud of, not only because we were on the right side of the biggest moral question of our age, and I still firmly believe that to be true, but precisely because I worked on it with John. We would meet at 15 Barland Street on the south side of Glasgow and at 16 Woodlands Terrace in the grandeur of the STUC's offices with its views redolent of the cityscapes of Oscar Mazzaroli. John's job title at Scottish CND at that time was administrator. But John Ainslie was no bureaucrat. He was an activist, a thinker, a campaigner, a writer, a protester, and a man of the highest principle. Just listen to his simple but arresting opening line in that pamphlet. A Trident submarine is designed to destroy a continent and to kill 200 million people. In the ensuing years, he became an internationally respected authority on nuclear weapons and nuclear disarmament, and no one knew more about the road convoys of warheads travelling through Scotland than John. Acutely aware of the dangers, the risks, the hazards, the unintended consequences, as well as the illegal and immoral intended ones of the nuclear arsenal on our doorstep, he warned that central Scotland from the Clyde to the Forth could become a desert because he knew that a nuclear war could start by intent, but it could also start by accident. The replacement of Polaris with Trident was controversial on its own terms. By 1994, when we wrote the pamphlet, according to the National Audit Office, there had already been an £800 million overspend. But Trident didn't just bring about the proliferation of public money. It brought about the proliferation of public terror. And, of course, it brought about the proliferation of nuclear weapons. And now, 30 years later, we are drifting towards Trident's replacement with the Dreadnought programme. We are doing it in conjunction with the United States, we are told, working closely to ensure it is compatible with the Trident strategic weapons system. In other words, we remain a client state to the US. And this is at a time when we know that there is the possibility of the return of Donald Trump to the White House. Looking back 30 years ago, I wrote at the time, Trident is a triumph of the military complex over the needs of the impoverished. It is a triumph of foreign policy over social and industrial policy. And I stand by those statements. I can't think of a better time to launch John Ainslie's archive than now, because he did ask the critical questions. He pioneered the use of freedom of information laws in search of truth and transparency. And what better way to honour his memory than to continue with his work?
Finally, John knew that nuclear weapons do not bring stability, that they corrode the very foundations of our civilization, that if we do not destroy these weapons of mass destruction, they will destroy us. I remain an inveterate and unrepentant supporter of unilateral nuclear disarmament, and in John's memory, we rededicate ourselves today to that great cause.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. And I now call on Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm delighted and honoured to be closing today's debate on behalf of the Scottish Government. And I would like to sincerely thank Bill Kidd for bringing forward this motion and to express my appreciation to him and the wider cross-party working group on nuclear disarmament for their continued work on this important issue. I realise I'm at risk of repeating some of what's already been said. However, it is important to begin by recognising the work, important to recognise the legacy of the subject of Bill Kidd's motion and this debate, namely Reverend John Ainslie, who sadly and prematurely passed away in 2016 after a battle with cancer. And today's debate is a testament to his years of campaigning and his research on nuclear weapons and on disarmament. He was, as others have mentioned, a former British Army intelligence officer. He worked tirelessly for many years as part of the Scottish Campaign for Nuclear Disarmament, and he was appointed its coordinator in 1992. And this was also the year of the first of Reverend Ainslie's 20 reports on nuclear policy, the last of which was published in 2016. The reports covered a range of issues, including the practicalities of British nuclear disarmament and Scotland's contribution to it, the costs and the risks of the UK's nuclear weapons modernisation programme, and the humanitarian consequences of the use of nuclear weapons by the United Kingdom. In addition to authoring reports, Reverend Ainslie collected a vast number of documents, over 3,000 of them, primarily related to the UK government's nuclear weapons programme. And it's fitting that this debate is taking place on a day celebrating the return of that archive to Scotland, with events here in Parliament and at the National Library of Scotland, including an exhibition of some of the original documents. The whole of the collection is being added to the National Library. So for those involved in digitising the archive and returning the physical files to Scotland for permanent storage, they are all to be commended. If I can briefly reflect on the contributions that we heard to Bill Kidd, I think everybody in the chamber, regardless of their views on the issues of nuclear disarmament, unilateral or multilateral, which I think we're all committed to one or the other, I certainly hope we are, Bill has been an unceasing campaigner for nuclear disarmament, and he deserves recognition from all of us. I was pleased to be able to attend the International Conference on the Humanitarian Consequences of Nuclear Weapons with him some years ago, and I can attest to his deep commitment to this issue. To Rona Mackay, quite rightly, reminding us all of Bairns Not Bombs, something that many of us have had on bumper stickers and are closely associated with the feeling of relative priorities when it comes to nuclear weapons against social policy. To Jamie Green, I have to say how gracious, how thoughtful to make the contribution that he did, notwithstanding the differences that he had with those of us who support a different approach to nuclear disarmament, that he could find a way, very graciously marking his respect for John Ainslie without taking issue with his commitment to how we can secure a more peaceful world. And to Richard Leonard and his joint publication 30 years ago, he must have been a very, very young man at that stage, obviously, the publication that he co-wrote with John Ainslie. I hope that if it's not already in the National Library, it will be. So I would commend him to check the inventory there, and let's make sure that that's part of the wider collection as well. The Scottish Government's position on nuclear weapons is clear, it's long-standing. We are firmly opposed to the possession, to the threat, the use of nuclear weapons. They're strategically and economically wrong, they are indiscriminating, and they are devastating in their impacts. Their use would bring unspeakable humanitarian suffering and widespread environmental damage. And it's worth noting that every single signatory of the Non-Proliferation Treaty, all states, including the United Kingdom, are publicly committed to nuclear disarmament. Frankly, we should get on with it. The Scottish Government has consistently expressed a commitment to remove nuclear weapons from Scotland in the safest and the most expeditious manner possible following a vote for independence. This position was last set out in the one of the Building a New Scotland series of papers titled An Independent Scotland's Place in the World, which I launched in March of this year. Nuclear weapons are obsolete, they are dangerous, they are impractical, yet in 2021 the UK government broke their commitment to the international community by increasing the nuclear weapons stockpile to no more than 260 warheads. This is in fact a 40% increase from their 2010 commitment of no more than 180 warheads. And in March of this year, the Conservative government published a command paper which set out that the UK's nuclear weapons are the Ministry of Defence's number one priority. It's disappointing, if not entirely predictable, that the new Labour UK government is launching its strategic defence review in July and reaffirmed there its commitment to the UK's nuclear arsenal. Breaking the commitment to the cap of 180 warheads is completely at odds with Article 6 of the Non-Proliferation Treaty, to which the UK government is a signatory. Two independent defence experts from the London School of Economics have also concluded that the UK's increase of warheads constitutes a breach of Article 6. Nuclear weapons do not provide a meaningful deterrent to many modern-day threats, such as terrorist attacks, nor have they proven a deterrent to other nuclear-armed states carrying out atrocious acts, even on UK soil. Rather than making repeated and damaging cuts to conventional military forces and capabilities, the UK government would do better to use the £41 billion it's spending on replacing Trident to invest in modern conventional capabilities that are relevant today to today's threats. The Scottish Government supports the objectives of the Non-Proliferation Treaty and the International Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. We recognise the key role that the international community has in collectively creating the conditions for a world without nuclear weapons. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, as I have said, the Scottish Government firmly oppose nuclear weapons. We wish to see the Dreadnought programme to replace Trident scrapped, with the £41 billion of taxpayers' money put to better use, and will continue to call on the UK Government to do just that. Finally, and most importantly, I'd again like to thank Bill Kidd for bringing forward this motion and members for their contributions. The Reverend John Ainslie was not a person who sought the limelight, but through his expertise and through his commitment to peace, he shone a light on the terrible weapons of mass destruction on our doorstep, and I hope that one day we can achieve what he fought so long for, namely a nation free of nuclear weapons. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting until 2 p.m. Thank you.